So for this episode of The Vote, I'm here with Garry Peltzer Dunn, Councillor Garry Peltzer Dunn, and you're from the Wish Ward, aren't you?
Conservative. That's right, dead right, yep.
First time as well, I think, on The Vote, with myself anyway, and we're going to start off with talking a bit about the lockdown. Garry, what's your reading of the situation? It's difficult for everyone, isn't it, at the moment?
It is. I think, you know, some people actually are in a worse position than others. But in the end, we've just got to come down to what is good for everybody. And, you know, all right, we're going to have 4 weeks. At least it's a finite period at the moment. And hopefully we'll come out of it. More people being safe. You know, it's a dilemma, isn't it? Do you look after the economy and therefore say, all right, the economy's been saved and it was a price worth paying, more people dying? I don't agree with that. I think people are more important than money.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, a lot of people have lost their lives, haven't they? But then on the other side of the coin, you do kind of feel sorry for people that have done everything that they've been asked to do by the government, PPE, all the social distancing measures, the retail sector particularly, which is quite big in Brighton, isn't it? We're kind of a big destination for the retail, and you've got to feel for them, haven't you?
Oh, you've got to feel totally for them, and it must be heartbreaking, having gone through the first lockdown period, to come out of it, to really get yourself back on your feet and doing everything correctly, just to be locked down again. It must be soul-destroying. And, yeah. You know, we must all have sympathy with people who are affected like that.
Yeah, and one hopes that maybe the things will be good and much better early December, and so they can at least get a bit of the Christmas shopping period, but, you know, that big running, which is crucial for a lot of retailers.
Oh, it is. I think it's absolutely essential that if there is an opportunity to come out of lockdown, that we do and give the public... Well, the public want Christmas. The traders want Christmas, so everybody wants Christmas, but it must not be at the price of people's lives.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, hopefully we'll be in a better position. We'll see how it goes. And I know the government have put in support for local businesses, haven't they? And the council have as well. So it's never going to be enough, though, is it? Really, it's never going to replicate what you would get, you know, if you were opened up on a day-to-day basis.
No, it is purely amelioration. You know, if you're going to have 100% loss, if you can settle with only having a 50% loss, that has to be better. No one's going to be ever fully compensated, but we must try to protect not just the businesses, but the employees as well. And also, we must remember that there are millions of self-employed in this country, and that's why it was very good yesterday, the announcement that the scheme for the self-employed would actually operate for a further 3 months from the beginning of this month.
Yeah.
So that, and I think it's only going to be, I say only at 55% of their profits,
yep,
which they can prove for previous years at the same time. But at least it is a help.
Yeah, exactly. And we'll be looking back on this as a difficult time, and hopefully next year there'll be a vaccine and it'll look a bit different. Because some people need a bit of hope at the moment, don't we? We all need a bit of hope, yeah. And we need something on the horizon to look forward to.
Well, yes, I think there's no doubt about it that, yes, we must look forward. But on the other hand, perhaps if we just look back a little bit and go back to the first lockdown and people's experiences then, which continued on afterwards, I firmly believe that one good thing may come out of COVID, and that is that there's a greater feeling of community.
Yeah.
And I think that is evident by the various groups which have grown up, not just within my own ward, Wish, but throughout the city, and in fact throughout the country. So if I said caring COVID, it means a result from COVID, that we might be more caring and worry about other people other than just ourselves.
Yeah. What's been going on in the Wish Ward then in terms of the mutual aid groups? I know there's been a lot of good stuff.
Yeah, I think, and it's not just in Wish, I say it is citywide.
Yeah.
You know, groups from food banks, you know, with Portslade, which obviously Wish joins and we contribute to church groups who have been very, you know, active, to the Westhoe Forum, which has assisted local organisations getting together and helping. It has been mutual aid.
Yeah, exactly. And we're going to need that in the future, aren't we? Because a lot of people are going to be struggling, and no doubt about that. And particularly youngsters, you know, young people with families, and you feel for children, don't you, at this time as well? At least we're keeping the schools open, which...
I think that's probably important, to keep the schools open, which must help the parents as much as the children. But I do feel that, you know, sort of at the end of the day, the important thing is that everybody is safe, and whatever good has come out of bad in the past with COVID will continue on.
Yeah, yeah. Moving on to other local issues. So I know there's been an issue with petitions, and particularly with the Urban Fringe Residents Association to put together petitions. What's the update on that, Garry?
Well, the petitions, which I think were very important and were, in fact, a basic element of democracy, you know, sort of with regards to the city plan, people were asked to comment and put their views in. And I think quite reasonably, as in fact it came through the council, that people were asked to make their comments so that they could be taken into consideration, that in fact there were various groups around the town who in fact were vehemently opposed to certain elements of the city plan and got petitions going round, getting hundreds if not thousands of signatures, and then thinking they could come to the last city council meeting with an order to present them, only to be told no, that it wasn't a valid form, and in fact they would just have to present it to the actual inquiry. You know, and I think a lot of people, you know, maybe legally the advice given to the mayor was correct, but I think from a public perception point of view, people felt that they were being shortchanged. And let me ask you a question. Here you are, you live in an area where it's going to be, you think, adversely affected by the city plan. You felt so strongly, you spent hours and hours every day getting a petition, thinking that it could be presented, just to be told it can't be. What would your feelings have been?
Exactly. I mean, it would be, you'd want that petition looked at properly, wouldn't you, in the process? So. Yeah,
to be seen to be looked at properly. Whether, in fact, I say there was a legal nicety which prevented it, it could have still, I was thought, been presented and told legally after it had been presented that it can't be debated because of this legal nicety. But at least people would have felt that they'd had an airing.
Yeah. Do we need to change the rules in that area then in for future petitions? Is that an area to explore?
It's difficult because this was such a specific example. There were other examples might come up. I can't think of them at the moment. You've put me on the spot here.
Yeah.
I can't think of them at the moment. But in fact, any system should have the space to be able to move around and ameliorate.
Yeah.
And if you're so dogmatic that it can't be, that I think, you know, what is the point of being able to support or oppose if in fact you can't because it's so dogmatically laid down?
Yeah, and I think it would, the thing that was missing then was a debate, because the petition would have led to a debate. So the thing that people wanted was that debate, and that didn't happen. Is that right, at full council?
Oh, yes, totally. It didn't happen at full council. And I think, you know, I think people were surprised and then disappointed, because with so much public feeling, on Latest Home, you had lots of information on it. The local press had lots of information on it. And it was reasonable that the city council meeting to, in fact, you know, talk about this amongst other things, just ignored it. No, you can't do it.
Yeah. So what is that it now for that then? I know you submitted the petitions in with the consultation.
In our goes, and that will be considered, and then we will get the answer back, you know, from the authorities as to what, you know, our responses.
Yeah, and that consultation's ended now, hasn't it? I think it ended last month.
It has, and, you know, the Conservatives have put in a very detailed response. To that.
To the city plan.
Yeah.
We'll talk about it in the second half as well, but I know you've got something about signage in the city. I know you've been a long-standing councillor. Just start off with talking a bit about, you know, how we can better represent some of the heritage in the areas that make up Brighton and Hove.
Oh, yes, right. You know, I'm a Hovearian, and proud of it. But we are part of the city, and the city encompasses everywhere. But it somehow, I don't think that the areas should be subservient to the just the title of the city of Brighton and Hove. Portslade has an identity of its own. Marlowe has an identity of its own. Aldrington, Rottingdean, Kemptown. And I do believe that there should be room within the city to accommodate areas that people identify with.
Yeah.
You know, because, all right, in the old days, all right, we used to live in Hove, and I think I was partially responsible for, you know, the Hove actually phrase, because, you know, people asked where you live, and you said, well, Brighton, no, Hove actually. You know,
yeah.
And, you know, I didn't feel guilty because many towns the size of Hove were totally independent, as Hove was.
Yeah, yeah. All right, we'll leave it there for the first half. We're going to be talking to Gary a lot more in the second half about his long-standing career in council and also about local issues. Join us then. So back here with Garry Peltzer Dunn, the Conservative councillor for the Wish Ward, and talk a bit more about signage. It is important, isn't it, for local residents to feel an affinity to their local area, as well as to the Brighton and Hove, the city. So have you got any specific examples in maybe your area over in Hove?
Well, I think when you're coming into the city, you see Brighton and Hove.
Yeah.
But then you also see signs which say to Brighton and to Hove. And it's nice, to, I think, for people to know when they're coming, where they're going to. But I think it's even nicer for residents, you know, if they live, let us say, in Aldrington, that they know that, you know, they are in Aldrington and it's part of the local identity.
Yeah.
It's very much so, shall we say, maybe the local identity at the moment in some areas of the city, you could say, would be shopping areas. You know, the Grenadier in Hangleton, that's the Grenadier area.
Yeah.
You know, and people identify with that. That's their, it's theirs.
Yeah.
And I think that's it. It's a sense of ownership.
Yeah.
And, you know, for visitors alike, I cannot see why you can't have area signs within the city.
Yeah. And is that something you're going to talk about at the council or have been
I did actually propose a change to the city plan, but that was actually voted down.
Yeah.
My colleagues supported me, but unfortunately, Greens and Labour voted that down.
Yeah.
Feeling it was unnecessary. But I think it's important to take residents' feelings into consideration.
Yeah. I know on the council you work on the Scrutiny Committee. Just tell us a bit about what the Scrutiny Committee does. It doesn't get the attention maybe that it probably deserves, because we need a lot of scrutiny, don't we?
Yes, we do need a lot of scrutiny.
Yeah.
I have to say that it's not the most charismatic of committees, and therefore, because of that, I think it's a question that people feel it has to be done, but it doesn't, you know, get the headlines. You know, scrutiny, we scrutinise the finances of the council. You know, we have talks and approval from auditors on the council's accounts. We also are responsible for the conduct of councillors and officers. And in fact, if there is a complaint against a councillor, obviously the scrutiny committee has that investigated.
Yeah, and is it? Do you meet regularly then? I mean, do you scrutinise the work of the other committees?
Oh yes,
right.
It's the umbrella scrutiny,
yeah,
for not only council but for each and every one of the committees.
Yeah. Okay. And is that it meets regularly? I mean, do you have any powers to kind of get councillors or to get the council to look at things?
Oh yes, absolutely.
Right.
And sometimes, in fact, committees may say that they're maybe, shall we say, unhappy about something, and they ask the scrutiny committee to actually look into it.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a self-policing thing, but in fact, it's very detailed. And also, we do have on the scrutiny committee two independent persons who are not councillors, but who actually give advice to us. And I think that's very important, because it does mean that there is an outside influence. So it's not just the council judging the council.
Yeah, which is always really important
in any institution. Absolutely vital.
Critical. Yeah, absolutely critical. I know you've been a councillor since, I think, 1972, Gary. So just tell us a bit about the highlights, because you remember Hove Borough Council. I just about remember it, but I know you remember it as well. And you were part of the whole decision-making for us to go in with Brighton. I mean, how was that? Was that a long time coming, that decision? And
oh, well, you know, sort of you missed out a council, actually, because when I was elected to the old Hove Borough Council.
Right.
And then following reorganisation, the Hove actually then became totally independent of the East Sussex County Council, and it was a separate authority adjoining Brighton. And we always felt in Hove that we maintained our finances. And we actually, 3 years in a row, actually had a zero local rate because we actually lived within the rate support grant, which was deemed appropriate.
Yeah.
You know, when it was mooted that we're going to go in, you know, these big unitary authorities, Hove had a choice whether to go in with Brighton, because Brighton immediately wanted to come in with Hove and, you know, literally gobble it up. That was their view. But Hove did actually look at going westwards to see whether they could amalgamate there. But I have to say, although I can remember going to London and, you know, sort of saying to the minister, well, you're just putting, you know, Conservative Hove on a plate for being taken over. It was poo-pooed. But only myself and Councillor Brown-Rowe actually voted against going in with a different authority, because we knew, sure as fate, Brighton and Hove were synonymous together, Brighton and Hove Albion.
Yeah.
You know, it was so obvious that we were going to come together. So we came together, and of course, immediately, Hove lost, I think it was about £8 or 9 million cash reserves, and in return, managed to get tens of millions of debt from Brighton. So it was a really good bargain for Hove.
Yeah, I mean, because you're right, I mean, it did return Conservative Council, didn't it, the Borough Council back in the day? I mean,
oh, yes. You know, yeah. In fact, I was a member, I'd say, in that from 72 on to 95. I lost my seat in 95. Conservatives were soundly defeated because of the Shoreham Harbour sheep protests of exporting sheep.
Yeah,
from
I remember that.
That's it. So we lost. Yeah. Notwithstanding that, all right, I seconded a motion opposing it, but we lost, and that was it. So actually, then I turned out to be probably in Hove history the most unsuccessful Conservative candidate, losing three times in a row trying to get back before I got back in 99.
Yeah.
And then that was only by 6 votes.
Yeah.
That was a close run thing.
Yeah, exactly. And it was a close one last time, wasn't there, up in Angleton and Knowles?
That was very close.
Yeah,
you know,
with Nick Nowry.
With Wishwood, we always work hard. I'm very lucky having such a partner, you know, really, with Robert Nemeth.
Yeah.
You know, in fact, we increased our vote, which I think was relatively rare.
And you've got a distinctive way of doing stuff, haven't you, over in Wishwood? So it's very obvious, you know, you're both high profile, aren't you? And I mean, you get stuck in.
Oh, yes. We try to be. Obviously, since lockdown, it's been more difficult. But, you know, we always used to have three, surgeries every month for residents, one of which for 20 years was in my own house, because I believe I live in the ward. People should better come and see me in the ward, rather than saying, oh, no, you must go to the town hall or a church hall. You know, that's not a criticism of other councillors, but I felt...
Is this a unique way of doing it, or a kind of a certain way of doing it?
Oh, yes. Yeah. You know, and in a way, it can be very fulfilling, in another way, frustrating. If I want to go around the corner to Tesco's, it might take me quite some time to get there, because I meet people who want to have a chat.
Yeah.
So that's really nice. But if it's starting to rain and I get soaked coming back from Tesco's because of talking to people, I get frustrated.
Yeah.
But yes, no, it's nice. I think it's important, you know, you know your local area. And unless you know your local area, it's difficult to actually be able to feel that you can represent them.
Yeah.
You know, and know the local problems.
Yeah. Just before we finish up, is there anything you would miss from the Hove Borough Council then? I mean, what...
Well, I think...
There's pros and cons each way, isn't there, on that?
I suppose things come back, not to haunt you, but I was responsible, under the old Hove Borough, of having the King Alfred redeveloped and rebuilt at the back. There's a new swimming pool. We managed to get the money by flogging some allotments. So yeah, we got £4 million and that paid for the revitalisation of the King Alfred.
Yeah.
Some years ago now. My daughters are now well over 50 and they were little youngsters who had the first swim in the King Alfred. It was a freebie, so I'm declaring it now. I got a free swim for my daughters in the King Alfred.
Yeah.
You know? But then another thing, you know, sort of Hove always said was said to be behind Brighton. You tell me, where was the first cycle lane? Can you name it?
Was it in Hove?
Yep. Can you name where it was?
Hove Seafront.
Yeah, Hove Seafront, yep. Along and down. I managed to get that through. So in fact, Hove had a cycle lane before Brighton.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I remember those old taxis with the purple and white livery for the old taxis. I mean, it was. I mean, maybe it couldn't have carried on Hove Borough Council because you need economies of scale nowadays for bin collections, etc. You kind of need a more joined up approach and kind of a bigger population in order to make it work.
Yes, I think there is supposedly economy and scale. I think, you know, you it shows how things have changed.
Yeah.
You know, sort of take shopping. Hove had a half day on a Wednesday and Brighton on a Thursday. So of course you could whip over the border because you didn't have passport control between Hove and Brighton. Yeah. It was an open border. Yeah. So, you know, you could cross over and do shopping whenever you wanted.
Yeah.
But yes, the local identity, you know, Brighton, yeah. I always remember. Do you remember the old white helmets with the policemen in the summer?
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
yeah.
And they patrolled in Hove, you know, and it was part of the summer.
Yeah, exactly. And then obviously George Street, were you part of the, because that's kind of worked, the pedestrianisation of George Street, I would say. I was down there the other day and been there quite regularly. And we'll leave it there. We've run out of time. We'll have to do it again, Gary. Thanks for coming today. Cheers.
No, thank you very much.